Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow. I know He watches me.
Is that wonderful? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us begin this morning by singing together as a way of centering ourselves in worship. From the Red Book, number 126, we will sing it twice, He is Lord. Number 126. Hymn number 26. Worship through the video later today. grace and peace to you as well. Gratitude to Susie DeShane, who will be reading our scripture from 2 Samuel this morning. And I did talk to the Browns this week, in fact, again yesterday, and she's still struggling some, and so they did not know if they would be here today, but we're not planning to contribute to the service through music quite yet, as she continues to get stronger and to recover. So let us continue to keep Richard and Elizabeth Brown in our prayers, because we know they were always here in worship with us and provided music quite frequently for this service. So we miss them for many reasons. As we come together in a time of prayer, not only the Browns, but we also lift up, continue to remember Jane Lockerman, who is undergoing treatment for pancreatic cancer. She did get back to the doctor late this week as a follow-up to an MRI, and the reports are encouraging. There appears no growth and no spreading of the cancer, so we give God thanks for that. Jane will continue with the chemotherapy treatments every 2 weeks. She received, she did receive one on Thursday, but again only received two of the three that she had early on been receiving. So she will continue with that plan over the next couple of months, the every 2 week treatment. Is that right, Alex?
That is correct. And the chemo that they took away was the one with the most side effects. And it's been just like night and day. She's a totally different person when they have taken that.
Good.
That chemo. Yeah. She's just.
And no plan to restart the other one, the third one, right now.
To restart the other one, and the other mm-hmm. one, oncologist said that no one has all at once the same throughout the treatment time.
Okay.
And also, she's got another scan in August. And she's got an appointment with the surgeon in August the 30th.
Okay.
So that she's got to have that surgery to survive.
The surgery will happen at some point, and so she will have that consultation in late August. Is that right?
August the 30th.
August the 30th. Good. Good. Thank you. And please send all of our thoughts and prayers as you return home today. Bill and Marge Buzzell, we continue to keep in our prayers. And, of course, William Sharon as well. Are there others that you would like to lift up today, or other concerns? We, of course, continue to hear in the news and lift up the families that were involved in the condo collapse in Surfside, Florida. And we know that there is still recovery of bodies, and our prayers are extended to those who have died and to their families, loved ones, friends, who continue to wait for additional news. So, other prayers you would have? I would also want to lift up, as I ask you, other things come to mind, lift up the country of Haiti. Haiti has the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, and has been for a long, long time, and a lot of disruption in that country, even more so now with the assassination of their president, and would ask that we lift up the people of Haiti in our prayers as well. So,
Mark, my niece in California is having a lengthy surgery the end of this week. She's been battling colon cancer. She's a young mother.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll involve three different surgeons, so it'll be about a 7-hour surgery.
Is that this week then?
Yes.
You said, okay. What's her
Sandy.
First name?
Sandy.
Sandy. Okay. Prayers for Sandy in California, who's undergoing treatment for colon cancer. Thank you, Susie. Are there others you'd like to lift up? Yes.
My sister's friend Joni had surgery to remove a brain tumor, and they think the surgery was successful, but they said she has a really long recovery ahead of her.
Prayers for Joni, who is in Oregon, has had recently brain tumor surgery, for her recovery from that. Are there any others?
The rescue squad took Justine to the hospital again this week. She's back home. Yeah, stuff gets.
She had a short stay in the hospital.
Yeah.
Okay, prayers for Justine. Yes, Al?
I have unspoken.
Unspoken prayers. Good. Let us pray together. Gracious God, as we enter into this time of prayer, may we recall the words of your great prophet Isaiah, who said, "Even youths will faint and be weary, and young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." As we gather in this time of worship, O Lord, give to us that hope and that trust that you are the means, that you are the way that gives to us strength to be able to see through any circumstances of life that may confront us. Be they small, be they large, be they physical, be they spiritual or mental, whatever they are, we know that your Spirit is working in our lives, and that as we wait upon you and seek from you all that we need, that these things you give to us. We pray this for the people of this congregation, where there may be those present today in worship or those who are listening to the video of worship, that where there may be needs in any of our lives, concerns, we may wait upon you and receive from you the word and the strength that we need. May we hope and trust in you for every need that we do have, confident in the presence and abiding work of your Holy Spirit in each of our lives. We pray for the leaders of this nation, for your continued wisdom and strength that you might give to them, not only those nationally, but also in our own local communities. We pray indeed this day for the people of Haiti. We know it is not easy to live in a country that is stricken with so much poverty and oppression. And now on top of that, the assassination of a president. Bring peace to that country, and may the countries that surround it and the countries of this world find ways to touch their lives and offer support and care for them as a nation, as they seek to rebuild, as they seek new leadership. May your wisdom and your presence guide and direct them. We pray for all those who may suffer, for those in trouble around this world and within our own local community. We pray for the needs of people that we are aware of who have concerns of mind, body, or spirit. We ask for your healing grace with Elizabeth Brown, with Bill Buzzell, with William Sharon, with Jane Lockerman. We pray for Joni and Justine and Sandy. May they trust in you for needs that they have, and may your healing grace work through those who tend to them in the medical field. We pray for those in Surfside, Florida, who are still moving through the devastation of the collapse of the condominium. Those who are emergency workers, those who are working to continue to clear the rubble and to find human bodies. We pray for families who have lost loved ones and friends. May you comfort them and give them the strength that they need to see through this time. It reminds us that our skills as humans are not perfect, that oftentimes we are at fault, that we do not always have what we need to construct buildings or to construct government or to construct whatever it is that our hands are involved in. Forgive us where we falter and fail. O gracious God, hear the prayers too that are unspoken this day. As in these moments ahead of silence, we lift up our own prayers unto you. We pray for those who are absent from us. We pray for continued concerns regarding the COVID pandemic. We are aware that there are ever-increasing concerns about variants from this virus. We pray that we as a nation, we as a people, might work together to continue to bring healing and the possibility of normality in life. Hear these our prayers, which we offer unto you this day. In the name of Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. There's a singing group that I think we're all familiar with, and this song entitled River of Jordan was written by one of the members of that singing group by the name of Peter Yarrow. The singing group is Peter, Paul, and Mary. I traveled the banks of the River of Jordan to find where it flows to the sea. I looked in the eyes of the cold and the hungry, and I saw I was looking at me. I wanted to know if life had a purpose, what it all means in the end. In the silence, I listened to voices inside me, told me again and again. There is only one river. There is only one sea. And it flows through you. And it flows through me. There is only one people. We are one and the same. are all one spirit. We are all one name. We are the Father, Mother, daughter, and Son. From the dawn of creation, we are one. Every blade of grass on the mountain, every drop in the sea, every cry of a newborn baby, every prayer to be free, every hope at the end of a rainbow, every song ever sung, is a part of the family of woman and man. That means everyone. There is only one river. There is only one sea. And it flows through you. And it flows through me. There is only one people. We are one and the same. We all are one spirit. We are all one name. We are the Father, Mother, daughter, and Son. From the dawn of creation, we are one. There is only one river. There is only one sea. And it flows through you. And it flows through me. We are the Father, Mother, daughter, and Son. From the dawn of creation, we are one. From the dawn of creation, we are one.
The reading this morning comes from 2 Samuel chapter 6, verses 1 through 5 and 12 through 19. David again brought together all the able young men of Israel, 30,000. He and all his men went to Bala in Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who was enthroned between the cherubim on the ark. They set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, sons of Abinadab, were guiding the new cart with the ark of God on it, and Ahio was walking in front of it. David and all Israel were celebrating with all their might before the Lord, with castanets and harps, lyres, timbrels, sistrums, and cymbals. Now King David was told, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the Ark of God." So David went to bring the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. When those who were carrying the Ark of the Lord had taken six steps, he sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. And wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord with all his might, while he and all Israel were bringing up the Ark of the Lord with shouts and the sounds of trumpets. And as the Ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. They brought the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. After he had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord Almighty. Then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each person in the whole crowd of Israelites, both men and women. And all the people went to their homes. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O gracious God, in what to each of us seems at times to have parts of our body that are small, like a tiny brain and a tiny heart, yet we know that within those things, within our minds, within our brains, within our hearts, there is the fullness of your presence, which is much greater than anything we can ever conceive. May your holy word be opened up to us this day. May small words of yours become a large message to each of us. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. I don't think this church has one that I know of, but I know churches will do this, organizations will do it, but they'll make time capsules. We don't have a time capsule here, do we? At Antioch? No. But I know that there are churches, say, that may be over 100 years old, and when they built their sanctuary, their church, 100 years ago, they may have had a special service of dedication of that sanctuary, that church, and they put together a time capsule. We all know what a time capsule is. It could be metal, it could be plastic, like a tube, and you put inside of there, say, the first bulletin of the church, the first bell ringer for Sunday school, or, you know, whatever it is. You put in there things that are historical, that were part of that church's beginnings. Maybe the church board minutes of one of the first meetings. Maybe the charter that was established. Anything of that nature. Maybe a picture that was taken of the people who founded that church. And then sometimes you take that time capsule and you put it behind the cornerstone of the church when it's built. And then some years later, you can take out that cornerstone, and there's that time capsule. Maybe you're going to do it 50 years from now, 100 years from now. And the congregation hears and sees what's in that time capsule. And the fascinating thing about a time capsule is it's so small, but what's contained in it is huge. It tells a history of 100 years ago and the people who founded that congregation and what they did and who they were and what they were like. And so while the capsule may be small, its message is gigantic. And I want to focus on that a little bit this morning by looking at this passage from 2 Samuel. And I want to put the reading in a little context, because we haven't been reading 2 Samuel in recent times. But when you read these 14 verses from 2 Samuel this morning, we note that the name David is in almost every line. Therefore, he's obviously the center of attention. However, we also note that God and the Lord are also mentioned. Therefore, the divine one, God, is also very central to our reading. And as we all know, there's a very special relationship between the person of David and God. God designates David to play a very special role in God's work in human history through the Jewish people. And as we read about David throughout various parts of the Old Testament, we come to know that David is a mixed bag. At times, David is strong. At other times, he's weak. At times, David is morally upright, and at other times, David is morally corrupt. At times, David is very generous, and at other times, David is very selfish. Perhaps David sounds like most all of us. The good news is God uses David. We all know that in our Christian faith and literature, namely the New Testament, David is also talked about. He's talked about in relationship to Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus is in the lineage of David. And the kingdom which Jesus brings into this world is likened to the great kingdom which King David establishes around 1,000 years before Jesus, as David became king over the united monarchy of Israel and Judah. Jesus begins his life somewhat as David did, as a person of humble means. David was a shepherd boy, and Jesus is a small town carpenter. And both are raised by God from places of humility to a place of great significance and influence. David gains fame, as you recall, as a young boy when what? When he's credited with conquering the Philistine by killing the great Philistine giant Goliath with a single stone from his slingshot. Kids at Vacation Bible School love that story, don't we all? At this time, Saul is king. And at times, David would be called upon by Saul to soothe his anxieties. Saul was dealing with some kind of illnesses, and David would be called upon to play healing music on his lyre. And of course, we know that David is known to become a great songwriter. Many of the Psalms in Scripture are attributed to David. When the story moves along, the prophet Samuel informs King Saul that God's not happy with him because Saul has failed in various ways to be obedient to God. And so Samuel informs Saul that God plans to replace him as king. And when David becomes a hero because of putting down the great giant Goliath, David rises to the forefront as a candidate to be next king. Well, Saul had allowed David to marry his youngest daughter, a young woman by the name of Michal. But Saul, in developing this jealous rage against David and fearing that David would do a coup to overthrow him as king, Saul attempts to have David killed multiple times. And David has to flee for his life. And yet, despite Saul's jealousy toward David and his attempt to kill him, David remains faithful to Saul. In fact, David's wife, Michal, is put in a difficult place. Because David is her husband, and Saul is her father. And so she's almost caught having to choose between allegiance to David's growing influence and power and her father's failing attempts to preserve his kingship. In fact, if you read further in Samuel, you'll see that Michal actually saves David's life. When Saul sends warriors to get him, to capture him and to kill him, what does she do? And she's a very minor character. She doesn't appear very often in scriptures and in Samuel. Very minor character, and I'll say more about that in a minute. But what she does is she puts statues in his bed, like a statue, and it looks like he's in there sleeping. And she helps him escape out the window and get away. And so she makes her commitment to her husband David. In fact, some suggest that she's the only woman in the Bible that tells her husband she loves him. at least the words that are there. You don't know historically, of course. Certainly they're more than that. But her words in the scriptures of Samuel are that she loves David. Whereas the story unfolds, it doesn't take King David long when he becomes king to do his own stumbling. Saul is killed in battle and David becomes king. But as he looks down from his royal balcony, he sees a young woman, a story that we also know quite well, by the name of Bathsheba. She's bathing. And he desires her and he gets what he wants. Although David is married to Michal and Bathsheba is married to someone else. And that someone else to whom Bathsheba is married is eliminated from the equation by King David. So as I said, David is this mixed bag of strength and of weakness, of moral uprightness and moral corruptness, of generosity and selfishness, like most all of us. And when David is anointed king, one of his first acts is to regain in Jerusalem, as the capital of his empire, and to bring back to Jerusalem the Ark of the Covenant as the center of worship. Now we know the Ark of the Covenant is a small gold-covered chest or box, a very small little thing, bigger than that of course, but a very small chest adorned in gold. It's described in the book of Exodus as containing what? It contains the two stone tablets of the Ten Commandments. We can understand why it was such a holy box. The Ark of the Covenant was created after the Israelites fled from slavery in Egypt. It was created according to a design which God gave Moses. It happened when Moses got the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai, and they encased them in this ark, and they carried it on their 40-year journey through the desert, placing it always in front of them, leading the way. And they, when they would camp, they would put it in a tent called a tabernacle. And at some point during the reign of Saul, the ark was captured and taken by the Philistines. And so one can understand why there was that adversarial relationship between Israel and the Philistines. But in our reading for today, we hear the marvelous story of how King David brings the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem, to the capital of his kingdom. In our reading for today, we hear what a great special event that is. Probably like opening a time capsule after 50 or 100 years. A small chest, a small box, but in it something huge. The Ten Commandments of the Lord. Well, we're told that as the ark is brought into Jerusalem, there's tremendous rejoicing, as you might imagine. It's a huge festival. There's songs, lyres and harps are playing, and tambourines and castanets and cymbals and dancing everywhere. And we read that David himself, as king, is caught up in the festivities and begins to dance with his linen apron on. Something which you don't usually wear by itself. And the reading seems to imply that it was way too revealing. And in today's reading, we're told that Michal, who's David's wife, who I've already talked about, sees David in his ephod dancing, leaping around in front of the Ark of the Covenant, and she despises David in her heart. The one who said she loved David. Perhaps she finds his behavior to be childish, to be lewd, despicable, sexually vulgar, and she seems to be the only one trying to hold David accountable as God's servant. It's always interesting to try to understand these minor characters of God's holy word, like Michal. We don't know much about her. Like all women at that time, very insignificant. The first wife of many wives of David. And really, when it comes down to it, David uses her as a political pawn. He marries her as part of his trajectory of becoming king of Israel. And he later brings her back. When Saul marries her off to someone else, he later brings her back as his wife, representing the dynasty of Saul. Small things, like the Ark of the Covenant. But within it are the Ten Commandments of God, something huge that has guided the people of God for thousands of years in a tiny box. Michal, a small, insignificant woman, but lifted up by God to hold his servant accountable. Think about this. The young man gives to a young woman a very tiny box. Very, very tiny one. And when she opens it up, what's in it? A diamond ring. A small box, but what's inside that box is huge, isn't it? It represents a commitment for a lifetime. A love that's undying. Years of coming to know one another, of having experienced one another, of forming love and ideas about their future together in that tiny box. There's something huge. As I was sharing with the children, it's like a small town library. You go into that library, but when you begin to sit down and look at the books, it opens up a huge world, doesn't it? A little bit like Tolkien's Legend of the Rings, Lord of the Rings. But a huge world, that book, and that series opens up. One book alone can open up a huge world as you read it and enter into it. My word to us today is that I think that's the kind of people God creates us to be. When you get to know another human being, we should always know that in that human being is so much more than we can ever imagine. Years of experience, years of growing up, years of love, years of relationship, years of work, years of vocation. And we're called, I think, as the people of God to get to know each other in a way that's deeper than just the surface, just the outside, just the box. Because that box of who we are opens up a huge world of experience and of relationship. I know as a pastor over the years, when I would come to a church, one of the most exciting things to be involved in visiting homes and getting to know your members was knowing that in each single life, there's so much more than one can ever imagine. And to get to know that life for each of us opens a world not just of a human life, but of how God has worked in that life. As we hear the story of David and Michal today, a woman who really seems like a small package, someone insignificant, somebody little, yet she's one that married the servant of God, David, in the lineage of Jesus. She's one that saved his life. She's one that called him to accountability as a servant of God. So much more in each person that meets the eye. May you and I be those kinds of people of God. As we live and breathe and enter into relationship with one another, to know that in each person is a world of God seeking to be known and to be loved. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 378. Let us stand as we join in singing hymn number 378, Take the Name of Jesus With You. Savior Jesus Christ, go with you all. Amen.